Hi everyone, my name is Mark and you are live with us here at Juma Game Reserve. This is Wild at Safari, beautiful Sunday afternoon, and we are surrounded by animals at the moment, mostly impala and wildebeest. Don't know what else is hiding in the bush, and we're going to be driving around for the next few hours to see what there is hiding in the bush in the immediate vicinity. Within about I'd say probably about a 3 or 4, maybe 5 kilometer radius, we're going to see what we can find for you. Most of the impala are all spread out. Very relaxing afternoon, obviously a very hot day, not much chance of predators moving around, other than cheetah, funny enough, but there'll be so seldom cheetah here that these impala fall into sort of a false sense of security without them around. But they know that leopard, lion, hyena are not likely to be hunting this time of the day. Leopards sometimes though, and well, the wildebeest are just a little bit west of us. They're all lazing about in the bushbriar area. Are we heading out? We're going to go and see what we can find for you today. Very peaceful. It's almost like they know it's a Sunday afternoon. Blue skies, a little bit of cloud way down in the south. We'll watch that. There's the characteristic big thunderhead brewing over the escarpment way down in the southwest over the mountains. That's not going to affect us at all. And a little bit of cloud up in the northeast. Other than that, it's going to be a lovely hot day. Perhaps being a sunny hot day, Sunday, we'll go to some of the dams, have a look at some of the water holes, see if there's anybody having a mud bath, maybe some elephant swimming. And I guess we should start at a place like Treehouse Dam. It'd be a good place to start. Warthogs. 1, 2, and 3. Big female. 2 piglets from the previous year's litter and 3 piglets from the new litter. Let's see if we can just have a look at them. There was a warthog killed near Treehouse Dam. I thought it was one of this little group. Obviously not. They do roam quite far. They have a den site. They'll have a burrow in a termite mound where they sleep at night. Warthog can't sleep out in the open, they've got to sleep underground. They do have a very specific or a very set circadian rhythm that means they have to sleep at night. They're awake during the day, unlike the impala, which are awake all the time. But the warthog can move quite a distance from their burrows during the day, and quite often in the evenings we see them commuting home after they've been in places like this. Some animals you will find that move around day and night, but you have some creatures that are very, very strictly diurnal or nocturnal. And this is one of those strictly diurnal creatures, the warthog. Highly unlikely to see them out at night. Their cousins, the bush pigs, on the other hand, predominantly nocturnal. Don't think any bush pigs would occur here. Maybe down KwaZulu-Natal. Oh, let's move on. I forgot my sunglasses on my hat. Hi Lucas. Doesn't start. Beat the engine with a hammer. The ground that we covered this morning, which wasn't that much, but the area that we did cover, we didn't have too many tracks to follow up on for this afternoon. The lion that we had here yesterday have moved on. The sticks evidently went north. The Majingalans evidently went south. Funny enough, just after we closed down, I did find some leopard tracks in the riverbed at the Spaghetti Junction. And I can go and have a look to see. They weren't very fresh though. They looked fresh in the wet sand, but moving out onto the drier sand, you could see that they were a little bit older. And, well, there was a big herd of elephants that came across Wertheller Access Road from Aubrey's Road and headed south. I think they must have crossed Triple M. They must have gone southwest. find any sign of them on Zoe's Road. So, it's like all new today, this afternoon. We're starting from scratch. Nothing really on the cards. Of course, everything is on the cards. We're always looking for things. We're always on the lookout for exciting stuff. But sometimes it's got to start with finding tracks. Sometimes it's just coming around a bend and there's something in the road and it's unexpected. And that's perhaps what we're hoping for this afternoon, is an unexpected surprise around the next corner. Take a slow approach to Treehouse Dam. Hello, Dove. Nobody in the mud wallows at the top of the dam. Surface of the water in this windless hot afternoon is like a mirror. Mama duck sitting in the tree is probably watching over her two ducklings, if she is the mother of the two ducklings. But that's the female comb-billed duck up in this knobthorn. Maybe look a little closer if there's a duck sitting in a tree and she's not on the ground feeding, not around the edge of the water, we're in the shade. Could be that there's something here that is preventing her from going down, keeping her up in a tree out of reach. Be moving around here at the moment. You can hear some waxbills and firefinches some of the small seed eaters who are very water dependent. Only enjoying the benefit of a full dam and easy access to the water. Okay, let me move on. There have been buffalo around. There are buffalo tracks on both sides of the dam. Oh, run, little Franklin. The road runner. Well, weekend for everybody. Hope you're all having fun. Of course, we can step things up a bit on the drive this afternoon. I'm sure we have a lot of people. Not only Sunday afternoon for our side of the planet, Sunday morning for North America, South America, Sunday night for Australia, New Zealand. Probably getting quite late on that side of the planet. But send me something, questions at wildearthsafari.tv. Let's see what we can talk about. We are going down to Twin Dams. We're now in Weaver's Nest. We're going to take a side road, the firebreak, down to Twin Dams and see what we can find there. Maybe we'll sit there for a few minutes, find a shady spot. Not too many of those around Twin Dams, but most animals move around constantly. There's some animals, as we've seen on the open area near camp, the wildebeest, the impala, although they're constantly moving around, they're not moving over very vast, very large areas. They move off of that open area, often during the day, going into the thicker wooded areas. They'll invariably come back to the open area at night. You could say that things like the impala, wildebeest, some of the few animals that tend to stick around, but just about everything else constantly on the move, never in the same place, unless we have a situation where we have lion on a very large animal kill, like a buffalo or a giraffe, in which case they might stick around for a couple of days. Or if we have leopard on a kill, they might be around for a couple of days. Other than that, everything moves around because it's no good being in the same place all the time. If something's going to get used to you being there, it's going to be be an easy target. Which is surprising, really, because we have had those wildebeest and the impala and the warthog. They are pretty much resident to that open area near camp. And only every now and then do we get a predator coming through there. Obviously, if a predator come and stay there, those animals would move on and they would find somewhere else to spend their nights. Another open area, which would probably be off of our traversing area. Surprisingly, there are not that many predators around that open area, other than our resident leopards. Lion that came through last night didn't even stay around long enough to even see what animals were available. Curiosity how those Majingulans came up north, sat around for a day and then went back south. I guess they were just testing the waters, especially since they roared a little bit, probably hoping to get a response from their neighboring lions, who of course would have been the Kahumas. Okay, let's skip Twin Dams for a minute and go and see what's down there at Baboon Pan first, and we'll come back this way and head to the western side of Twin Dam. Looks like there could have been elephant around today. Fresh green leaves on the ground that are somewhat wilted. Not today, maybe yesterday. Look at that impala ram on the damn wall. See if he can, if he'll stop. Quite a nice picture there. Net, I think, but I don't know who's in the passenger seat. Oh, sorry, Seb. Sorry. Gotta wait until we zoom out before I start. Ruin the shot. Baboon Pan is pretty quiet. ducks. Uh-oh. Sorry, children.
Yes, this is.
I've disturbed the white-faced ducks. A couple of their ducklings scrambled across the road and the two adults flew up. So I don't want to stop there. I don't want to disturb them. Split the adults and the ducklings. Lion tracks. Excuse me. This was the Majinga lions last night. Heading south. Twin Dams doesn't seem to have much happening at the moment. Other than that one Impala ram. One of those hot afternoons, I guess. Hello, Wee Pat. Asking if the baboon had a baby yet. Well, Wee Pat, we found five of the baboons this morning. It didn't seem to be a new baby there, just the one that has her baby already. So I don't think so. I couldn't tell you. We didn't get a very good look at them. I think it's a show of their intelligence to some degree. I've seen Graham when he's been busy with those baboons. He'll ride up to them on his quad bike and stop right in the middle of them and get off his quad bike and photograph them from only a couple of feet away. Or they'll walk past him within where he could stretch out his hand and touch them. And they've gotten so used to him, and it they won't allow any other human being anywhere near them. And this morning we saw them, but as soon as we started watching them, they moved away. They get a little bit self-conscious, I think, when we're watching them. There's an incredible book. Any of you are interested in the life of baboons and an insight into their lives and their intelligence and their perception of humans. There's a book by a chap by the name of Eugene Marais. M-A-R-A-I-S, Marais. The Soul of the Ape. Okay, granted, baboons are not apes. His other book, The Soul of the White Ant, was about termites, and granted, they're not white ants. But Eugene Marais spent some time with a troop of baboons out in the west, northwestern part of the country. And they could recognize him coming over a hill from a mile away, whereas if it was another human being, they would be a lot more wary. There's a leopard track, but that's when the sand was wet. Going to say mud, and then I said sand. So I said manned. Mud and sand is manned. Very interesting book. You can actually buy the two books together nowadays. Now, this is a gentleman who lived in the 1920s, 1930s, 80 years ago. He was an attorney, a lawyer, I think. But he chose to live his life out in the open, in the wild. I think he had a few issues. But that was his business. And of course it was translated from the Afrikaans, but it hasn't lost anything in the translation. And two very nice books. Great read, both on the insight and the insight into the lives of baboons, but also from a layman's perspective, the lives of termites and his postulations, his thoughts, his ideas on termite colonies that were way before his time. I mean, it's only since science has been able to study termites in a lot greater depth that we've got an understanding of them, a better understanding of them, and an understanding that he must have had some insight into their lives that the average human doesn't get. Something that I can relate to. So we are now at Chelapan. And another Impala ram. And he's starting, he's actually, if I stop we might hear him. But he's making that very distinctive growling, rumbling, snorting, roaring noise that Impala rams make when they are rutting. So he's selecting this as his rut, as his lek, as his bowl, or his arena. Good access to water, got some good grazing. Just in front of us on the right, we will probably be able to notice this little patch of ground. There are a few droppings here already, and we're going to put this over to how he starts turning this into a midden. Only a few droppings at the moment, but he will start scratching at the sand here and depositing his dung. And probably declaring this his arena, hoping that when some females come anywhere near him, he can capture them and keep them here during the mating season. Let's go around onto Chelapan. He's standing behind the leadwood. He's hiding in the shade there now. My guess is that he's just chased off another ram. The reason why we saw him out in the open running, and the reason why he maybe was doing his rutting snort a little bit early, I'd say. Normally only starts around the end of April. I guess the early Impala catches the ewe. If you don't mind me adapting an old cliche. Now we're playing hide and seek with this leadwood tree. Franklin's a shouting down in the riverbed. We need to go and have a look at that. Hey, Mr. Marla. Look at him. He's in his prime. He is... Oh, don't run away. Okay, he ran away. Well, let's see, there's a Franklin chirping. There were leopard tracks down the bottom here this morning. Let's go down into the riverbed and see what there is. interesting question, and I hope I can answer, from Ellen in Illinois. Hello, Ellen. I'm just going to go through the back here before we go down into the riverbed. Poke my nose in the bush where it doesn't belong. Ellen wants to know what distinguishing features there are that, well, what distinguishes apes from monkeys and baboons and other primates. Well, we have the great apes. The great apes, which actually just should be part of the hominid family, really. Gorilla, chimpanzee, bonobo, orangutan. And then you get, I mean, everything is a primate. Everything belongs to the group of primates. And you get the great apes, gorilla. See, I don't know where we fit in. We should fit in with the great apes. But then again, the great apes should fit in with us. They should be. They should be hominids, under the group of hominids. You know, I think we share more DNA with chimpanzees and gorillas than do two different species of weaver birds. They're they classified together. The simians, then you get, well, I think, let me think, I think the orangutans are classed as simian. I know Tara probably knows this better than me because she's done zoology and she's done the theory of it all. Prosimians, simians, then you get the, well, the monkeys. And the baboons are two different, because baboons are not monkeys. Monkeys are not baboons. What physiological features there are that distinguish them? I don't think I could tell you, Ellen. Get stuck again today. Such a beautiful, cool glade, this damp river sand. I wonder. One would expect to see something down here in this lovely, cool riverbed. Maybe that's just it, one would expect it, that's why there's nothing here. What we're going to do is Nyala Road South, Nyala Road North to Biffleshoek Dam. I guess something I need to look up on, something I need to read up on, what it is that classifies apes as apes. Perhaps the lack of a tail. Monkeys as monkeys. Baboons. terminology.
Classification. Hornbill's got something in his beak. Actually, this. It's like a caterpillar. Red-billed hornbill. What is doing? It's so perfect. We're sitting in the sun. What it's doing is rubbing the caterpillar along the edge of the branches before it eats it. And that's probably because the caterpillar has fine hairs on it that can irritate the gullet, the crop, the stomach. Gotta rub all those hairs off. Yum, tasty. A red-billed hornbill. A little bit smaller than the yellow-billed hornbill. Another warthog up ahead. Two warthog, three warthog, and they're off before we even get there. Leopard tracks here too, but these tracks are when ground was wet, so they're old. Too old to get excited about. 6 Franklin, 5, 4, as they peel off, 3, and they find a gap, now just 1, come on little one, thank you, yeah, the tree, oh, there's a skink on this tree, wouldn't have seen it unless, well, it's gone around the other side. Problem with lizards and skinks and things. And a funny looking male giraffe. His left horn is a little bit longer and a little bit strange actually. Good afternoon, giraffe. And he says, oh, it's just humans, and he goes back to feeding. And I want to go forward because it's going to push him deep into the bush, so I'm hoping that... Excuse me, Squire. Come out. Come out of the bush. His left horn is thicker and longer than his right horn. I wonder, could have been maybe... Oh, maybe it's just a genetic thing. Want some water? Now that was quite strange, because he was happy enough to just stand there watching us. And there goes another one, another young bull, just running across our bows. But something startled a Franklin behind us. It could have been us. Could have been a Franklin that just suddenly became aware of us. And it was because of that alarm call of that Franklin that these giraffes got startled. Quite strange. It was quite happy to just watch us like that. Perhaps not too sure about what we were about. And, well, they moved off deeper into the bush. I don't just about see one of them through the trees, but well, on we go. Wee Pet. Is the giraffe afraid of us and the car? Wee Pet, the same giraffe will react 10 different times when you view it 10 different times, if you know what I mean. You can approach, you can be, see the same giraffe 10 times in 10 different circumstances, and the giraffe will react 10 different ways. A giraffe's reaction to a vehicle and to us depends on the surroundings. In fact, most of it, I should say. If we're on open ground and the giraffe can see well, and look, giraffes have got very good eyesight, but because their heads are above the trees and they don't see very well what's down below here, and they're quite nervous when it's thick vegetation like this. If it was open ground, he would be a lot more relaxed, he would be a lot more accommodating. But under the circumstances there, Franklin gave an alarm call. He might not have run away because of us. He might have run for a couple of reasons. We didn't see that second bull because of the density of the vegetation. That second bull could have been moving around, and that second bull could have frightened the Franklin. And that, you know, just triggered a chain reaction. That could, in itself, could have chased that bull. But generally, giraffes are quite relaxed with us. They're more relaxed with the vehicle than they are with humans on foot. And quite often, you can view them quite happily without them moving off. But as I say, it's all dependent on how dense the vegetation is, as well as whether there are predators in the area. If a giraffe senses a predator, he's going to be a little bit more skittish. Or she. Those are two young bulls just getting into adulthood. sounds like all the lodge vehicles are heading out on safari this afternoon. Making things easier finding animals with a few more vehicles out. Mr. Hewitt, Alan Hewitt. Intense moments, or nice stories. A little bit of a broad question that, Alan. Not only 25 years of guiding and entertaining people in the bush, but also a childhood of growing up with it. It's always very difficult to answer a question like that because, you know, every single day some little, at least a little thing happens that is quite intense and quite incredible. In times that I've lived in other parts of Africa and I've been on foot almost all day, every day, I used to seek out what I called the gem of the day. Whether it was a feather or an encounter or a stone or a bird or an insect or a squirrel. Each day I would find something that would stand out above everything else, or all the rest of the activities of that day, the rest of the things that I came across that day. So in 40 something years of being exposed to this wildlife, it would be kind of hard to single out one particular thing. I think, Alan, if I could answer your question, it's just being here. Being here is the single most amazing thing for me. There's no other life, there's nothing else that I could do in the human world that would quite match up to the enjoyment I get out of doing this. And even though we might not see much like we did this morning, wasn't much around this morning, there's too much around this afternoon, we've still got a couple of hours, so we can always bump into something very exciting. There's always something around the corner somewhere. But just being here is exciting enough, just being here and the potential that right now, we're approaching Biffleshook Dam. I have absolutely no idea what is there. The water could be like a mirror, or it could be boiling with elephants. And it's that I think we'll sit and listen quietly for a little bit, just in case we might hear something. Oh, there's a starling eating something. Off to our right, looks like a big grasshopper, perhaps. huge grasshopper. Biting off the legs first. Too late, swallowed it. I think what we will do is we'll take this road on the eastern side here, go north up to Biffleswick Cut Line and do a loop and come back around onto the western side of Biffleswick Dam, just to see if there might be any elephant around that may be making their way down here. We don't want to rule out the possibility that there is something on the way here. So let's do a big loop around Biffleswick Dam and we'll be back here in, I don't know, however long. Maybe we'll take this track that brings us into the center of this island area. Very often I've been at a dam where it hasn't been much happening. You go away and come back a few minutes later and it's different. But what I tend to do at home when I'm at home is I take something to drink, I take some cheese and crackers, book, or just something to write on. Actually nowadays I can take my laptop. And I just sit at the dam a whole day. And you know, sometimes I can have one impala or one nyala or one buffalo or a warthog, maybe even nothing come by. But it's the most incredible time just spend sitting at a waterhole. There's always birds coming backwards and forwards, coming through the water and flying away. There's always something that's going to happen anywhere in the bush. Actually, patience is always rewarded, and if you just had to sit somewhere quietly and wait, you're bound to see something that is interesting, something that is different, whether it's a spider catching an insect, or an elephant swimming in a dam, an eagle hunting, maybe even just a flower. Hello Sharon in Pittsburgh, home of the Pirates. On the subject of spiders. And Sharon, I have to say it's nice to know that my remarkable creatures think, whoa, tree roots, marula roots, causing steps in the road. It's nice to know that what I do with remarkable creatures does help someone, if at least it's only you. Oh, a very interesting assassin bug flying there. I wanted to try and catch it. I missed. But yes, some people who have insect phobias or arachnophobia, and how it has possibly helped you. Excuse me a second. Let's see. There's something struggling in the mud here. They're clawed frogs that are in there. Boy, is that smelly mud. But there's a very interesting phenomenon that takes place this time of the year with all these... some rhino up near Impala Plains. Heading south. Okay, we're quite far away from that at the moment. So, Sharon, I'm going to get to your question in a minute. But it's funny, it's strange how nothing happens and then as soon as I start answering a question, I see something and I get distracted. There's a bunch of clawed frogs in that tiny little puddle and they're going to have to leave. They'll have to go down to Biffleswick Dam, not too far away for them. What they do every day. Some of the spiders die off. The golden orbs, for example, they're going to die off. These big, beautiful, big golden orb spiders that we are now going through. This one's caught a butterfly as well. And unfortunately, the mast, even the camera is going to get that one. There are a bunch of them here. Yes, but these golden orbs only live for a season. They hatch in the spring and it takes till now for them to grow as big as this. As the insects start emerging and the small grasshoppers and small insects start hatching, so do the spiders, so that they have these small insects which they're able to feed on. And as the insects grow, so do the spiders grow. This particular spider, only this one, the golden orb. And I was saying, what was remarkable about that little puddle of water with the grasshoppers that are floating about in it. Every little puddle that we're going to see now will have grasshoppers in it. And it's not like these grasshoppers fall in there and drown. There is actually an internal parasite that lives within a grasshopper. It has part of its life cycle in the grasshopper. Part of its life cycle needs to go into the water, and I don't know what the rest of its life cycle is about, but there's something that happens to a grasshopper's brain at the particular point where the life cycle of this parasite needs to change hosts, and it drives these grasshoppers into water so that this parasite can emerge out the abdomen. Because it can't live on land, it dries up very quickly. I've actually got one preserved in alcohol. It came out of a praying mantis once that I was playing with. Quite incredible. So yeah, a lot of dead grasshoppers in the water these days. Anyways, let me take a spider like a baboon spider, for example. The big female baboon spider that can grow as big as my hand. She will live to 15 or 20 years, so during the dry season, you will find that the entrance to her burrow will be covered in fine silk. She will still hunt if something comes by, because from the opening of a burrow, there's strands of silk that radiate outwards for some distance, and they like tripwires. Just looking into the west is a very typical big cloud that we've, almost every drive I've been on in the last couple of weeks, few weeks. Late afternoon to get this big cloud in the west. Just gonna go and have a look at. Oh, I wonder if we can get there this time. Maybe we'll see it on Biffles of Cutline. There's a tree with something in it. I don't think. Might just be bark hanging. There's a pair of sand grass in the road ahead of us. And they're gone. Double banded sand grass. Some spiders, whoa. Sharon, some spiders live for several years. We don't have such cold temperatures that they hibernate or they go into a state of suspended animation or whatever. There are still a few insects around in the dry season, and there's a spider feeding well now in the summer will be able to last the 9 months of the dry season, or not even 9 months, 6 months, without having to feed quite easily. The days are warm enough as well. It wasn't that jackalberry. Wasn't that marula? Was it possibly this? I don't know. I have to try and find this tree now that I was looking at. Jackalberry. One day we'll find something in the jackalberry. I'm going to go back to the firebreak. I'm going to come round to the firebreak because there was something in a tree and I'm not seeing it from Biffles of Cutline. And it might be nothing, but it's worth investigating. Branch hanging down or that jackalberry, that might have been it. With spiders in the northern Jackal and cuckoo just flew by. No, was that marula? I mean, that big jackalberry on the clip was a cut line that has a branch hanging. It made it look like something draped over a branch. Just the way the branch grew and then broke. There's a harmacop fishing. Well, frogging more than fishing. I can see you, harmacop. You can move. Standing dead still. Probably because there's a frog nearby. And he's waiting to strike at it. Don't think he's standing still because of us. Oh, no, I do. Looking at us out of the corner of one of his eyes. Ought to be quite easy frogging in a little water hole like that, because there are going to be frogs. And as the water starts drying up, it becomes easier and less time consuming. Playing statue. But the green that you're seeing is algae. And I bet that harmacop is thinking, frog's got to take a breath sometime, and there, a frog just surfaced behind it. Yeah, it kicks its feet, stares with the beak, but it'll move its feet around in the silt and hopefully chase things up. There we go, doing it again, doing a two-step. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's doing a three-step, not a two-step. Must have felt something there. This is where we learn about patience. There's so many things in nature that I've learned about patience from. Cats are one. Some of the birds, I mean the storks. The yellow-billed stork would stand there with its beak open. Ever the optimist that a frog's going to swim in between its beak. And sometimes it does. But it does take patience to stand there for an hour or so with your beak open in the water, waiting for something to swim between the two. After a day of this, I'd imagine this little hermacook gets a bit dizzy going around in circles in that little mud pan. There's got to be a frog in there that must have... It must have been taunting it, and he's intent on getting it. Like, I know you're here somewhere, I'm going to find you. Meanwhile, the frog's hiding out in the middle, and the hermacook is just walking around in circles on the outside. Try the middle. There's the middle. There. Too deep. This is probably one of the hermacooks we see at Biffleshook Dam. We're just north of Biffleshook Dam at the moment, in fact. If this water, if this little drainage line flowed, it would flow into Biffleshook Dam. Oh, nearly got something. Changed puddles. I was hoping by now he would have caught a frog, but, well. Can't be too many frogs around. Probably eaten most of them by now. Definitely a couple in that little puddle. Okay, let's leave him be. Good luck, child. Happy hunting. Interesting question from Pat, Wee Pat. Interesting. Well, Wee Pat's asking if I couldn't do what I'm doing now, what would I be doing? Interesting, Pat, because I've been through times in my life where I couldn't do what I'm doing now. So I think I could probably answer it with some hindsight, with some idea of Pat's saying it would probably be with animals, but what would I be doing? Well, no, I guess I'd find it in me to write about the last 40 years. My life on this planet. Ooh, slender mongoose just ran across the road. My life as a human, struggling to be in a human world. I don't do well in the human world. I mean the business world, the city world. There wouldn't be anything that I could do in the city. I've tried. But I honestly don't know what I would do if I couldn't do this. I spent almost a year, no, it wasn't a year. Yes, it was. Once upon a time, it was more than a year. I was debilitated and I was in no physical position to do anything about it. But it was that very state that I was in that sent me into a deep depression, because I thought I would never be able to be in the bush again. And it was daunting. It was a nightmare. That was 20 years ago. Well, we're back at the dam. We're now on the western side. I'm going to stop and listen again for a minute or two. Of course, gone underwater again now. There we go, just a few ripples. The Lost Biffleshook, Loch Biffleshook Monster. Very pretty little bird. Now we got some good sun on it. I think the grebes are related to the loons, if I'm not mistaken. Maybe we need to look at, somebody needs to find out about that for me. Are grebes related to your loons? Okay, let's move on. I think it's time to go up to Biffles of Cutline, or rather Cheetah Cutline, and see what we can find up there. Really lovely afternoon here at Biffles of Dam. Pat, thinking about it, I honestly don't know how to answer your question, because I really don't know what I could do. I mean, if I'm living in the bush, this is what I would be doing. If I'm not living in the bush, then I'm not living. Not very much I can do in the city. I couldn't work for a zoo. You see, one thing is that I'm not an academic. I haven't followed an academic path, which means that I don't have a piece of paper that says that I have a degree or something. Or a diploma, or a qualification, a formal signed by a dean on a certificate paper saying I have studied something. I have studied more than, well, I guess that stands to reason that in my lifetime of, and I still am reading, still am studying, my lifetime of living in books and observing nature and learning from nature, there's a lot more than, say, a 3-year bachelor's degree or even a master's degree. But in the human world, it doesn't count for much. In the human world, you've got to have that little piece of paper, and a lot of jink, a lot of jobs, a lot of things require that. Something's not right. This part. Rattling too much. Peggy saying I could be a teacher. Thank you, Peggy, and yes, I would love to. But once again, don't have an official piece of paper that says that I have learned what I have learned. I haven't written exams and satisfied some desk jockey that I can do what I'm doing. And so I wouldn't be able to get a teaching position without an official qualification. I'm a naturalist. I'm a pretty much self-taught naturalist. Actually, no, not self-taught, because nature has taught me. It's my passion, my interest, my desire to want to know as much about nature as possible. The fact that my books have only ever been natural history books. I've only really ever read stuff about nature. Only in the last, I'd say maybe 10 years or so that I've gotten into reading novels and stuff as an escape. And just mindless escapism. Quarry pan, got kingfishers bathing in it. We're going to cheat a cut line. Well, technology changes constantly, and yes, I suppose teaching would be an option. Could always do stuff through the internet. Thanks, Bill. Good answer there from Bill and Grebes and Loons. And back in, way back when, before science was it is what it is today, Grebes and Loons were thought to be the same family. And obviously, with advances in science, and I guess even more recently with the with being able to map the genome of it or looking at the genetics of an animal, it's changing a lot of things that we've classified together in the past. And so they're no longer together in the same group, Grebes and Loons. Okay, I need to look underneath this vehicle. There's something that is hindering my progress and making it shudder. Oh, and by the way, leopard tracks coming up from Gwari Pan up onto Chilakot line. I can't see anything, so I don't know what it is. Maybe the brakes are binding a bit. I think that's what it feels like, the brakes are just binding a little bit. But we've got a nice flat straight road to play on now, so we'll see how that works. Seems to be coasting fine. No sign of cat here. This could be one of the boys, these leopard tracks I was looking at. A little bit too small to be one of the big boys like Mbulo or Yambilu Yodan. Let's have a look quickly north of this junction. But since he came up heading east, he might have just carried on and gone into Torchwood. Good afternoon, Patty. Patty's one of our newer viewers. A question on spiders. She was doing gardening one day and there were a bunch of spiders coming out of a hole in the ground. And Patty wants to know how common it is for spiders to live underground. Depends. I hope you don't get tired of me saying that. So many questions have an answer that has to start with depends. See, we get so many different types of spiders. This leopard must have gone east because there's no tracks. There are no tracks. Might have come back again onto Cheetah Cutline at some point. Patty, there are a number of spiders that burrow. And live in holes. Some of them will have merely a silk lined burrow. Some of them will actually have silk coming out of the burrow. So it all depends on what type of spider we're talking about. Because you're not going to find a web spinning spider in a hole underground. This is not going to happen. Never. You've got more chance of finding a polar bear in Biffleswickdam than finding a golden orb spider in a burrow. If you get my drift. Spiders have evolved, nature has created spiders for almost every scenario. Most of the spiders that we have in the world are web live underneath the bark or live underneath a rock. Most of those spiders are harmless. Most of the free-range hunting spiders are harmless. There are a few, the brown recluse, which is one of them, which some of you may know of in North America. The brown recluse is quite venomous. You get a funnel web spider in Australia that can be nasty. And then of course the tarantula, which has a bit of a nasty bite, similar to our baboon spider. We have one species of baboon spider that is of medical importance to humans because of the effect of its venom on us humans. But all the other baboon spider species, there are only a few of them. Their bite will be painful, but not life-threatening. The one thing about spiders that one has to remember is that, whoops, you don't touch them, they won't bite you. Leopard tracks. So he did come back onto the cheetah cut line. And it looks like there's been a vehicle here. Let's see if he walks on top of this vehicle track. He heads south. Vehicles on top of him. Any station notice in Ingwem Konza on cheetah cut line this morning? Oh, so nice to have youngsters with it. Let me see now, here are leopard tracks almost on top of vehicle tracks, but that's yesterday's. One set of tracks here that are on top of this leopard. This leopard was here this morning. Young Kennedy! Look, Kennedy, 5 years old. Wow. Welcome to Africa, Kennedy. How often does it rain? Or does it rain here often? Or Kennedy's asking about the rain. We are at the end of our rainy season now, Kennedy. Soon we're going to not have much rain in our what we call winter. And I know it's not really winter because it's nowhere near as cold as you have it. I saw something on that termite mound, by the way. But it was just another piece of termite mound. I just didn't want to drive past and keep thinking for the next few days more. What if that was a leopard's head sticking out? Yes? Regan can tuck his brother. No, Kennedy's brother in Kentucky. Sorry, Kennedy and Regan. Regan. Say, are you guys named after presidents by any chance? But I don't quite understand the question. How big is the dam area? How big is the dam? Which one? I'm not too sure if I understand, but I guess about, if you're looking at Gowrie Dam, it's about the size of a football field. Oh, this leopard track. Oh, well, let's go south, who knows. Texan, come in. Do you know if anybody called in Ingwe Mkhonza on Cheetah Cut Line this morning?
Yeah, I call on Shock Mkhonza this morning.
Okay, he didn't follow up.
I don't think so.
Okay, thanks. Hello, Mongoose. Let's see if they're gonna emerge again from the little burrows. Colony of dwarf mongoose seem to all be in their burrows already this time of day. Sun hasn't even set yet. They move like they flow, almost feline movement, these little mongoose. Oh, they heard something. I can hear a starling shouting an alarm way off to the east. Well, we don't have much daylight left. I still want to go further south. We need to do a few turns around Drakensberg Drive, Leadwood Road, just in case this leopard is around, because it would be nice if we could catch up with him. These are relatively fresh tracks from today. Still heading south, and I want to follow up. So let's see what we can find. Bye, children. Make sure he didn't turn down Mumba Road. Now there are two sets of tracks on top of his, so this makes it a little bit more difficult. But since he was heading south, I'm going to give it a break here, head further south, and then see if we can pick up anything there. Keep in mind that so far the last tracks that I had were heading south at the Mumba Road junction. Pretty sunset this evening. Good morning, Sarah and Lisa. Mom Lisa, daughter Sarah. Sarah wants to know if there's any way of telling, I'm thinking you're saying young leopard tracks, whether it's male or female. I think when they're young, it's a bit difficult, Sarah. I guess maybe a professional tracker, somebody who knows a little bit more than me, might be able to tell the difference. I don't believe I can tell the difference. If we had, let's say, for example, Karula's cubs are male and female. And we think they are. We haven't confirmed that yet. But we think that's a young male and female. And let's say hypothetically it is a young male and female. We're soon going to be able to follow their tracks in much the same way as we track Mishu and Induna when they were younger. Before their tracks became bigger than their mothers. You see, adult, of course, adult leopard. Yeah, his tracks are still here, by the way. This leopard still heading south. Obviously, adult male is bigger than an adult female, so that's easy enough to tell. And even at 2 years old, Mishu and Induna's tracks are bigger than their mothers, so even at 18 months they were starting to get bigger than their mother's feet, their feet bigger than their mother's. Hippo coming out of the water and right next to the camera at the dam. Tuma Waterhole Cam, if you want to click on that link, open a new window. I won't mind terribly if you leave me and go and have a look at Hippo. See, now this leopard comes all the way down here, and here are some impala. But I don't see his tracks in the road anymore. So he turned off somewhere, 50 yards back. Monarchs. I'm just going to stop and watch these impala for a couple of minutes, so we've got lovely sunset from here. And that lovely glow of the sunset shining on these impala. I think They are semi-alert. Not fully alert. They're still grazing. Tails are still swishing. This is a perfect opportunity for a leopard. He's impala on the edge of the open area right next to some really thick cover. You can't zoom out.
Nothing right now. Sure. Check, it's freaking out.
Computer's complaining about something. We're just going to cut away at the moment, folks. We need to sort something out with this computer, so apologize for this. Really lovely late afternoon setting here. It's fine here, I guess.
Sunday's out.
Back again, folks. We're not too sure how long we're going to last, so we're just going to... This beautiful sunset that we have.
repeat that in English, please?
Well, hello, Regan. Regan, I think. Kind of sounds like it's spelt like... I know somebody who's spelt that way called Megan. Sisters in Kentucky. Sorry, I'm really sorry. I thought you were boys. I'll never forgive myself for that. But Regan wanted to know how big Biffleshook Dam is. It is probably about 3/4 the size of a football field in length, but it's quite deep in places. Goodbye, sunshine. Going behind cloud, behind the escarpment. Can hardly see the mountains today. A little bit dusty and murky. But what we can do, and as soon as we zoom out, we'll be able to see different layers, very pretty layers of cloud. Pretty heavy cloud building up in the south. And these impala have turned around. They were all looking at us, but they're all suddenly all looking to the south now. Well, not all, but some of them. Okay, we'll carry on a little bit. Wow, that is pretty. Let's have a look around. I've been hoping to hear at least some sound of, or some sign of this leopard's presence. Some alarm call, perhaps. So far, nothing. morning and the afternoon, and that's when they ablute, and that's why you will find droppings either on the eastern side or the western side of a termite mound, and it can help when one is looking for direction. I still don't seem to see any sign of that leopard crossing Gowrie Main. So I think he's still sitting there somewhere. Bill wants to know if impala can outrun a leopard. Almost definitely, Bill. Yes, they can. Why? That is why a leopard has to get really, really close to impala. Got to stalk, remain concealed, get really, really close to strike. And that's why the success rate of leopard on impala is not that high, because impala do run so far. And maybe that initial burst of speed from a leopard is fairly fast, but it's the consistent, the stamina and consistency that's important. Let's see if we can get past this pushed over some good stuff. Busy, yeah, this is the overgrown, no activity here at all these days. Warthog living in there. Look, I'm here because I want to go back to where those impala were, back up onto Cheetah Cut Line, maybe have a look around Leadwood Road. Wow, that's a difficult one. Look, April, Indiana. I don't think I can answer that question. What would I like to know about the bush that is not known? I don't know, that's too much of a twist on that. I don't quite. If it's not known, then I don't know that I need to know it. Sorry, madam. What would I like to know about the bush that is not known? Animal language. I would like to know animal language. Okay, well, elephant have been here and they've pretty much closed this road, so I don't know what we're going to do now. Try and push this tree a little bit. Too heavy to get the camera under there. Okay, just let me get out of here quickly. Elephant has really done a number here. Well, sun has set, it is getting dark, although we do have some time left for our drive. I'm afraid I'm going to have to say goodbye to you because for the second time now we've lost control of the camera. And this means that our 24 volt system has come to the end of its battery power. We're back here at these Impala, Cheetah Cut Line. So it's going to be difficult for Seb to operate the camera, even though it's getting dark now anyway. But, well, tomorrow's another day and we'll get this all on charge. I guess we can come back and up this way tomorrow. See if that leopard woke up and walked around a bit more. But for now though, unfortunately, we're going to have to say goodbye. We're quite far from camp. I'm sure I will be there before the end of the half hour, before the end of drive, and I'll try and come in and chat to you by the time I get back to camp. But for now, my name is Mark. Seb's been on camera. This has been Wild Earth Safari at Juma Game Reserve. And I hope you've enjoyed. It's been a little bit of a quiet Sunday. Everything's taken the day off. And tomorrow, Monday, everything's back to work. So we'll see those elephants and things tomorrow. Otherwise, they'll be fired. Bye, everyone.